Good afternoon, everyone. As you know that we were discussing the topic lipids. Lipids are basically water insoluble, okay? And these are categorized as bio micromolecule. And why are they known as bio micromolecule? Because their size is less than 800 Dalton. Is that fine? So that's why they are categorized as bio micromolecule, and these are generally water insoluble. If I talk about the classification of the lipids, then lipids are classified into three classes: simple lipids, conjugate lipids, and derived lipids. Now let us talk about all these one by one. Now, if I talk about simple lipids, then simple lipids, these are further classified into three classes: fatty acid, glycerol, and esters of glycerol. Now let us talk about all three. If I talk about the fatty acid, as you know, they are having a general formula RCOOH. They are having a general formula in which there is present a carboxylic acid group that is being attached with the R group. Now this R group, it could have carbon from 1 to 19. Okay, it could have carbon from carbon number 1 to 19. Let me give you an example of this. Example of a fatty acid is palmitic acid. As I told you earlier also, this palmitic acid is having how many carbon in total? 16. Now just suppose 16 carbon are there. One carbon is of COOH. Now for the R group, how many carbon are left in the palmitic acid? 15. 15 plus 1 becomes 16. Palmitic acid is having 16 carbon. Out of the 16 carbon, as you can see, one carbon is of the carboxylic acid group, and then we are left with the 15 carbon. And if you will draw the 15 carbon, this we have done, and if you will satisfy the valency, then you will get this structure. CH2 will come 14 times. CH2, it will come 14 times, and at the last you will get CH3. So this is the structure of palmitic acid. 1 carbon, 14 carbon, 1. 14 plus 1 plus 1, 16. So total we are having 16 carbon in palmitic acid. Second example of fatty acid is arachidonic acid. And in arachidonic acid, we are having 20 carbon in total. 20 carbon means, as I told you, the basic formula is RCOOH. So one carbon is there in the COOH group. So for the R group, how many carbons are left in arachidonic acid? 19. So you have to draw 19 carbon and then draw the, and then satisfy the valency with the help of the H group. Till here we have done, right? Now, the fatty acids, these are further classified into two classes: saturated fatty acids and unsaturated fatty acids. Fatty acids are classified into two classes, that is saturated fatty acid and unsaturated fatty acid. In saturated fatty acids, the double bond is absent. Clear? Only single bond is present. Like we have done the example of palmitic acid now. It is a saturated compound. Okay. But in case of unsaturated, double bond is present. We are not talking about the triple bond, because triple bond is not common. Although it is there, but it is not common in case of fatty acid. So in saturated one, the double bond is absent, and in unsaturated, the double bond is present. Clear? This is about fatty acid. Now, we are having the formula RCOOH. If I talk about glycerol, glycerol is hydroxypropane. Propane means how many carbon they will be having? 3. 1, 2, 3. Hydroxy means OH group will be there, and this OH group is attached with all the carbon. OH, OH, OH. Now rest valency you can satisfy. H, H. Fine? 1H. H and H. So this is our glycerol, that is hydroxypropane. Now let us move forward to esters of glycerol. Esters of glycerol, these are formed by the esterification reaction between fatty acid and glycerol. Am I clear? These are formed by esterification reaction between fatty acid and glycerol. Let me draw a structure that will be clear to you. But before that, let me talk about the different classes of esters of glycerol. These are of further three types: monoglyceride, diglyceride, and triglyceride. Esters of glycerol are of three types: monoglyceride, diglyceride, and triglyceride. If I talk about monoglyceride, then these are formed by the esterification between one glycerol and one fatty acid. These are formed by the esterification between one glycerol and one fatty acid. Is it fine? If I talk about the diglyceride, these are formed by the esterification reaction between one glycerol and two fatty acid. So diglycerides are formed by the esterification between one glycerol and two fatty acid. And for triglyceride, you can say it yourself. These are formed by the esterification reaction between one glycerol and three fatty acid. Let me draw the structure of triglyceride. After this, the simple lipids will be completed. Clear? Now let me draw the structure of triglyceride. So we are having triglyceride. Fine? As I told you, triglycerides are formed by the esterification reaction between one glycerol and three fatty acid. So let me make the one glycerol. 3 carbon, OH, 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 satisfy the valency, H, H, H. This is one glycerol. Now I have to draw 3 fatty acids. Fatty acids, you are aware of, they are having the general formula RCOOH. One is here R, C, COOH, you can write it like this, COOH. This is the general formula, COOH. Is it fine? Second, RCOOH. And third fatty acid, RCOOH. So here you can see I have drawn one glycerol and three fatty acids. Now one more thing. These fatty acids could be different. If they are same, then obviously R group will be same. But they could be different. So that's why let me write R1, R2, R3. So that I can explain that these three are different. These could be same also. I'm just giving you a hypothetical example right now. How the triglycerides are formed. Now there will be a esterification reaction, and in that reaction the water molecule will get lost. From here, one water molecule will get lost. OH will be given by the glycerol and H will be given by fatty acid. Again here water will get removed, again here water will get removed. So basically I can say three water molecules will get removed. H, let me delete it, let me erase it here and here. Is it fine? The same thing I'm doing here. So this is the structure of a triglyceride. It is formed by the esterification between one glycerol and three fatty acids. Fine. So now we have done the topic simple lipids, and in the simple lipids we have discussed fatty acids, glycerol, then esters of glycerol. Now let us talk about the second topic, that is conjugate lipids. Conjugate lipids. Basically, in these lipids, we are having fatty acid, glycerol. Along with that, we are having different groups like phosphate group. At that time, it will be known as phospholipid. I'll show you its formation. Okay. Means in conjugate lipids, we are having different groups. Phosphate group, or either it could be glycolipid. Clear? Now let me show you how the phospholipids are formed. With that, you will be able to understand its definition well. Example of a phospholipid is lecithin. Now let us draw the structure of lecithin. Now, here I am drawing the structure of lecithin, or I can just write phospholipid. In the phospholipid, in lecithin basically, firstly we are having glycerol, then we are having two fatty acid, then a phosphate group as the name suggests, plus a fourth group is also there, let us see. One glycerol is there, C, 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 OH, OH, OH. H, H, H. This is one glycerol. After this, I have to draw two fatty acids. Let me draw two fatty acids. R, C, O, O, H. This you know the general formula. Let it be R1. There are two fatty acids. Let me draw the second one. R, C, O, O, H. Two I have drawn. Again there will be a esterification between these two. I am just telling you how to make. Let me remove the OH group and H group. There will be release of water. So till here I hope it is clear to you. Clear? Water group will get removed. Till here is fine. Now, here we are having phosphate group, or I can say the phosphoric acid. Phosphoric acid, you know, it is H3PO4. Or if I elaborate it, it is like P double bond O, OH, OH, OH. Is it fine? Let me make it here. P double bond O, OH, OH, OH. Is it fine? Again, when we have to join these, we have to remove the water. Let me remove OH and then H. Again, there will be a bond. Is it fine? Now, here a fourth group is attached. That group is, when it will be attached, then H will get lost. Now, let me draw it. CH2, CH2. And with this C we are having N, and with this N we are having 3 carbon. CH3, CH3, CH3. So this is the structure of a phospholipid, that is lecithin. I hope how to draw it is clear to you. Now Now let us talk about the derived liquid. As the name suggests, derived means these are derived from any other compound. Its example is cholesterol. Now let us draw the structure of cholesterol. So if I talk about the structure of cholesterol, then you have to make the rings like this. One, then second here. Six carbon ring. Clear? Now, with this at the side, we are again having two rings. Two rings here and then again two rings. But they are at the side. One ring is having six carbon, but the second ring is the smaller. One ring, let me make it more clear. Clear? Now second ring. Now again one more ring is there, but that ring is open, you can understand like that. Again, like this, and then, so this is here we are having OH group. So this is the basic structure of cholesterol. Clear? Now one more thing, in your NCERT this structure has been drawn. But if you will surf the internet, then you will get a double bond here also. Okay, actually basically this structure is correct. But this bond is not drawn in your NCERT. In your NCERT this is being drawn. Is that fine? So this was all about lipids. Okay, now let us talk about the polysaccharide. But before that, let us talk about the carbohydrate. Carbohydrates, these are generally known as sugar. Clear? These carbohydrates are divided into three categories: monosaccharides, oligosaccharides, and polysaccharide. About polysaccharide we have to discuss in detail. Why? Because it is bio macromolecule. Now if I talk about these two first, monosaccharides are the simplest sugar. They cannot be broken down further. They can't be hydrolyzed further. Example is glucose. You can't hydrolyze the glucose. It is the simplest sugar. Is it fine? Second example is ribose. So these are monosaccharides, the simplest sugar. Let me draw the structure of glucose and ribose. Firstly, I am drawing the structure of ribose. Ribose is having 5 carbon. There is O group. Now, 1, 2, like this. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now you will say 4 carbon are there, because at the edges we are having the carbon. Here we are having one more carbon, C. That is basically CH2OH. Is it fine? Oxygen group, then 5 carbon are there. Now, let me talk about the rest group. OH, H. OH, H. OH, H. And here is H obviously. So this is a ribose sugar having 5 carbon and the structure is in the form of a ring. Is that fine? Now, let me draw the structure of glucose. Glucose is having 6 carbon, this you have learned, right? I have to draw 6 carbon ring. Again same oxygen. But now I'll not move like this. I have to make 6 carbon. 5 carbon are in the ring only and 1 is in the similar way as it was in the ribose. Just like this. Just count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's what I told you. And the 6th carbon will be there like it was in the ribose sugar. Clear? We are having the 6th carbon. CH2OH. Is it fine? Now again, let us complete the valency. The rest is same. OH, H. Is it fine? This is the structure of a glucose. So in monosaccharides we have done that these are the simplest sugar. They cannot be hydrolyzed further. If I talk about oligosaccharides. Oligosaccharides, these are formed by 2 to 10 monosaccharides. Means if two monosaccharides will be joined, it results in the formation of oligosaccharide. If three monosaccharides will be joined, again, suppose let me give you its example, it is sucrose. Sucrose is formed when glucose and fructose combines. How they combine, the nature of the bond we have to discuss. So oligosaccharides are this. Sucrose is an oligosaccharide. It is made by two monosaccharides, that is glucose and fructose. Oligosaccharides can be hydrolyzed further. If you will hydrolyze the sucrose, you will get back the glucose and fructose. Am I clear with this? Now, let us talk about the polysaccharide that is actually we have to do. If more than 10 monosaccharides unit are there, then it results in the formation of polysaccharide. Clear? If more than 10 monosaccharide units are there, then it results in the formation of polysaccharide. Now let us discuss the polysaccharide in detail. Polysaccharides are of two types. Homopolysaccharide and heteropolysaccharide. Now, homo as the name suggests, same. Means the monosaccharide units will be same. Example is cellulose. Cellulose is a homopolysaccharide. It is made up of the glucose unit. Many glucose are joined. So it is a homopolysaccharide. Clear? In heteropolysaccharide, glucose is the repeating unit in cellulose. Okay. In heteropolysaccharide, the different monosaccharide will be joined. Suppose its example is peptidoglycan. You know about cellulose and peptidoglycan. Cellulose makes up the cell wall of the plant. And peptidoglycan, it makes up the cell wall of the bacteria. So basically, in short, I can say the cell wall. It is made up of polysaccharide. Now, this peptidoglycan, it is a heteropolysaccharide. It is made up of different repeating unit. One unit is NAG. NAG. N-acetylglucosamine. Second unit is NAM. N-acetylmuramic acid. So what is happening in peptidoglycan? Suppose here I'm having energy. Then NaM, energy, NaM means these are repeating, but these are not same. But here in homopolysaccharide, like in cellulose, if one is glucose, second repeating unit is again glucose, third is again glucose, like this. So here in homopolysaccharide, the repeating monosaccharides are same. Obviously, they will be more than 10, but they will be same. And here, the repeating monosaccharides will be different. Is it fine? Now, if I talk about the function of polysaccharide, then one function, I think it is clear to you. They make up the structure, like cell wall of the plant is made up of cellulose. That is the polysaccharide. Cell wall of the bacteria, it is made up of peptidoglycan. That is again a polysaccharide. One more example is chitin. Chitin, you know, it makes up the cell wall of fungi. Plus, in case of arthropods, like in cockroach, you have seen, the exoskeleton is made up of chitin. Again, chitin is a homopolysaccharide. It is again made up of glucose unit. Now you will say cellulose is again made up of glucose unit. Chitin is also made up of glucose unit. Then what is the difference? The difference is in the arrangement. No doubt these two are having more than 10 repeating units. But how the repeating units are joined, these are different. Am I clear? Suppose, let me give you a basic example. Suppose I am having 4 carbon. You can arrange these like that also. You can arrange these like that also. These are different, two different compounds. In the similar way, no doubt glucose units are joined. But how many? How they are joined, this is different. Chitin is again an example of homopolysaccharide. So basically, first function of polysaccharide, it is clear, make up the structure. If I talk about the second function, first function is structure. Second is they store food. If I talk about plants, in plants, food is stored in the form of starch. This you have done. Starch is a homopolysaccharide. Starch is again made up of repeating glucose units. In animals, food is stored in the form of glycogen. Glycogen is again an example of homopolysaccharide. Let me erase it. In plants, food is stored in the form of starch. Starch is a homopolysaccharide. In animals, food is stored in the form of glycogen. Glycogen is again a homopolysaccharide. These all are made up of repeating glucose unit. But again, I'm saying how many repeating units are there, how are they arranged. It will depend and it will result in the formation of starch or glycogen or anything else. Is it fine? Now, if I talk about, okay, so we have discussed there are two functions of polysaccharide. That is, they make up the structure, and second, they used to store the food. Clear? Now, one more thing you have learned, that this starch is used to detect, basically iodine test. The iodine is used to detect the presence of starch. How? Let us talk about. You have done this experiment in your earlier classes also, that iodine is used to detect the presence of starch. Basically, this starch, no doubt it is made up of repeating glucose monosaccharides. But it is in the form of a helix, like this. About this, I told you in proteins also. So, the starch used to make a helical structure. And the molecules of iodine, if you are doing the iodine test, then the molecules of iodine can be incorporated in the helical structure. And now this becomes starch I2 complex. Clear? And this is bluish in color, bluish black, which results in the test. As you know that when you will use the iodine, and if the substance turns bluish black, it means it is having starch. Because with starch, the iodine will form this starch I2 complex, and this is bluish in color. Now, I'm clear with the topic polysaccharides.